Thanks for the invitation to talk. The only symposium we're playing on your phone is encouraged. So, this isn't working. Should I try this one? My only disclosure is that I prepared a 10-minute talk instead of an 8-minute talk, but we're going to talk fast and get through it, I promise. Over the past decade, the popularity of the internet has increased at exponential rates. 90% of Americans are online. This has led to a new concept for all surgeons, not just millennial surgeons, and that's online reputation management. Like it or not, patients are going online to find medical information, so we need to know what they see when they get there. What you're going to find out pretty quick is at least 80% of internet users are looking at health-related topics, and they're often looking for providers and institutions. When they do that, they're inevitably going to come across the third-party, unregulated world physician rating websites. Most of us are familiar with these. It's the innumerable third-party websites where you can go to rate your hospital, your doctor, and your experience, and a lot of us find it very frustrating. Utilization is going up all the time. Every time they do a survey, it's higher. The last one's 40% of patients, but they haven't done that for 4 years. It's higher for younger patients, specifically millennials, which is important to this symposia. 88% of consumers are going to trust an online review as much as a personal recommendation. 44% of patients are going to leave their network, go to an out-of-network doctor if the online reviews are better than the in-network doctors. And speaking specifically about millennials, 76% of them say online reviews are very important in their choice of provider. RateMDs.com is one of the more popular ones. You can see back in 2005, they had about 2,500 patient or doctor reviews. That ballooned up to 112,000 reviews by 2010. If you go on their website today, they boast over 2.6 million doctor reviews. So there's a lot of information out there. And it's not all positive. There was one study that showed that 40% of the reviews were either neutral or negative. So they're saying bad things about us. If you go to RateMDs.com, frequently asked questions, you're going to find out pretty quick that it's very difficult to have posts removed or to have your profile removed. Basically, you cannot opt out of this even if you want to. Additionally, these guys have a very antagonistic and litigious relationship with physicians. Lawsuits against them rarely work. They also have shady business practices. If you try to go on there and claim your profile, if you want to spend $120 a month, you can get the promoted plan. $240 a month, the Promoted Plus plan, which essentially allows you to hide negative ratings, and then you can even promote yourself on your competitor's page. There's a lot of concerns that are very legitimate for this. They have cryptic methodology. You can't validate the patient's truly your patient and or how many times they can leave a review if they're upset. And there's inaccurate physician information. I'm listed as an anesthesiologist from Wichita on that website, which maybe would have been a better idea, but I didn't go that way. You can't respond. If you go on there and argue with them, you have a very high risk of violating HIPAA. So it's basically a one-way street. There's no surveillance, and there's a lot of sample bias. You see hundreds of patients every year. You've got one or two reviews. This is a very important article. If you guys are interested, you can write it down. 2013 Bulletin. And what they saw when they interviewed the founder of RateMDs.com, and he gets legal threats from doctors every week. They never succeed. They also highlighted the story of somebody who tried to fight the system. Back in 2013, a neurologist from Minnesota filed a lawsuit against a patient's son for slander, essentially. He paid over $60,000 in legal fees. And this went all the way up to the Minnesota Supreme Court. The lawsuit was dismissed. The remarks were protected under freedom of speech. But more importantly, the story went viral. And so what happened is the patient had this flood of hundreds of negative comments to his page because he's so insensitive about this bad patient outcome. So that doesn't work. Now, I've had my own experience with this. Vitals.com, for years, relatively infrequent and relatively positive reviews. Then in 2013, started getting a lot of negative ones. Unhappy with my surgery, how I was treated, would not recommend, didn't take time to listen. I'm worse off now than before my procedure. He's more of a butcher than a surgeon, they said on there. I hurt my feelings. So I went online and I tried to fight back. I asked Vitals.com, do you guys look at IP addresses? Can you verify these information? They said, you're going to have a subpoena for that. So I got angry. I also thought the whole situation was unfair because I am a millennial surgeon too, and fairness is very important to us. Also, you start to question yourself. Maybe I'm a bad surgeon. So what am I going to do? I'm going to go online. I'm going to make it right. I'm going to claim my profile. I'm going to respond to get him to come into clinic. Thankfully, my non-millennial boss, John Thompson, is the voice of reason. And he pointed out two very important things that I want you guys to take home. If you go on there, these third-party websites, and you register an account, number one, you're validating the website. This is now a place where doctors address patient concerns. You're elevating their value. Number two, you're fueling the fire. These patients want a reaction. And if you go on there and react, you're giving them what they want and they're staying interested. And so his recommendation was to ignore it. kind of hard to do, but his point was that they're going to eventually become bored and move on to the next project. And as usual, he was completely right. So when it comes to third-party websites, I do not recommend that you participate. Don't respond to reviews, and don't drive your patients there trying to stack the deck, because also what you're doing is just elevating the site's value. So what can we do instead? First, you have to accept this is completely unfair. Just got to accept that. Next, you develop solid online defense. Try to place as much positive information in between the online consumer and unregulated website as possible. We do this with our knowledge of Google. 91% of searchers on Google don't go past page one. Over 50% don't even go past the third result. So if you look at what these reputation management companies do, they essentially flood the internet with positive information and they drive the third party rating further down the Google search. So hanging fruit, first one, contact your institution or your group, make sure there's algorithms they have that'll bring that to the top of the Google search. If they say they don't exist, get yourself a new website designer because they absolutely exist. And you can Google my name for results of that. Make accounts on LinkedIn, Twitter, Facebook, ResearchGate. These are invariably top results. If you Google me now, the first page, the first link is to my institutional website. Picture of me smiling, video of me talking about colon cancer, number to make an appointment. You have to go all the way to page three to find out how much of a butcher I am. And so this absolutely works. There is a more sustainable solution, though. And this is pioneered by the University of Utah. Is anybody from Utah in the audience, by the way? Great. So you know more than I do that they were having a hard time with scores back in the early 2005, 2006. Then they changed what they were doing, essentially, after seeing electronic questionnaires. They found out that there's a dramatic increase in response rate, and they took a big leap of faith that's become much more prevalent now, which is to publish their own ratings on their own website. Now, this is an unfiltered publication. That means both good and bad reviews. I'm going to pick on Bartley since he's a friend of mine, but you can see here that Bartley has great scores. And what they found out pretty quick, two very important things. Number one, more ratings means higher placement on the Google search. Number two, the scores that you get from actual patients to get to vote once are invariably better than they are in the third-party websites. I do the same thing. We started in April 2017 in my institution, and you can see here that my results are pretty good compared to vitals.com, and there's an occasionally negative ones, but I actually take them to heart when it comes from this page. Essentially, what I found out pretty quick is that I rush my patients. When I see 25 in an afternoon, I'm not giving them a lot of time. And very importantly, this online reputation management makes you slump-proof. People in the back of the room from UNMC know that our GI docs haven't been scoping very much recently, and I do colon cancer for a living. But because of my online reputation, your clinics remain full even when your partners are at the mercy of that situation. Okay? I've shared a lot of information, but this is soft science. People claim to be experts. Don't listen. Nobody is an expert. The true experts are PhDs in this. If you go online, you find a lot of contradictory recommendations against what I say. This is all in the publications when I did my own literature review. But there are some universal truths. One, participation is optional, but understanding is mandatory. No matter how old you are, you must have a thick skin to play the game, because you're gonna see stuff you don't like. Whether it's fair or not, whether you like it or not, patients are gonna go online to seek information. It's your job to find out that they have good information when they get there, and you're gonna have more success providing good information than you are battling bad information. Thank you.